Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and welcome to Station 14 in our beginning of the exploration of the lower limb. So we're going to start, as we always have, with the bones, then we'll talk joints, and then we will finish with the muscles. So starting with the most proximal associated with the lower limb would be these coxal bones, which are part of the pelvic girdle. Now, we talked about these already in a previous laboratory, but I just wanted to make sure that you remembered that this is going to be an important part of the formation of the hip joint. But we, since we've already talked about the coxal bones, are going to focus on the femur and the patella. So the femur is going to be the only bone associated with the thigh until you get to the very distal end, and then you are getting into the knee joint region. And you can see how the patella is going to be located anterior to the femur, or the anterior portion of the femur. So there's that close relationship between these two bones. So the femur. Now we are looking at a posterior view, and I don't have an anterior view here, but the reasoning behind that is because pretty much everything I want you to see, you need to look at this posterior view. So this is going to be the proximal portion of the femur, and this will be the distal portion. So this would be the hip joint portion, and this would be the knee joint portion. And this is going to be medial, and this will be lateral. And the reason I know that is because the head of the femur is always going to be directed medially because it's articulating with the acetabulum, and that coxal bone will always be more medial. So that really helps me. If I see where the head is, I know that has to be medial, and that can help me down here with the epicondyles and the condyles. So as you move distal, you have this pinched in area right here, which is going to be the neck of the femur. It, as you can see, is considerably thinner than what you have in the trochanteric region, as well as the head. This is a common area for fracture, so that misnomer of a fractured hip is often a fracture of the neck of the femur. And you can see that it is a little bit thinner in terms of the bone, so it makes intuitive sense as to why this would be more frequently fractured. Opposite to the head, so very laterally facing, will be the greater trochanter. And as its name would suggest, it is going to be larger than the lesser trochanter. The greater trochanter, again, as I mentioned, is going to be lateral. It is going to be a muscle attachment site for a lot of muscles to make it so large. So you're going to have the gluteus medius and minimus, as well as some of the more deeply placed lateral rotators of the hip. So not the gluteus maximus, but some of the deeper lateral rotators. And this lesser trochanter is smaller. It is going to be posteriorly oriented because we're looking at that posterior view, so that makes sense. And this is going to be the distal attachment site for the iliopsoas. Moving down to the body or the shaft of the posterior femur, you will see this line that's kind of running down. And this is referred to as the linea aspera. And this will be the distal attachment site for the adductors, or that medial compartment, many of those muscles in that medial compartment of the thigh. So dependent on how robust those are, the line could be larger or smaller, dependent on the individual. And then moving down to the distal end of the femur, you'll have the epicondyles and the condyles. And I find these kind of difficult to tell apart. So that's really where understanding this proximal portion of the bone will help. So if you know the head is medial, this makes sense that this would be the medial condyle, and this would be the medial epicondyle. That greater trochanter is always lateral, so this would be the lateral condyle, and this would be the lateral epicondyle. So those lateral epicondyles and medial epicondyle will be an attachment point for the collateral ligaments. And then, of course, the actual condyles are what are going to articulate with those extremely shallow tibial condyles in order to form the knee joint. Again, just quickly looking at the patelli, or patella, when you're only talking about one. As we saw here, they're going to be located on the patellar surface, or the anterior distal surface of the femur. And recall, these are sesamoid bones. So sesamoid bones are forming within tendons, so the patella is going to form within the quadriceps tendon, so that muscle is going to be kind of located right here. And then its tendon will extend down to this region as the patellar ligament, and the patella will form within that tendon. And so you can see this is going to be an anterior view of the patella, and this is a posterior view. And the reason I know this is that this posterior view is nice and smooth because it's directly articulating with the femur, so there'll be articular cartilage there. Whereas it's a little bit rougher here on this anterior side because it is not an articular surface. Okay, so that is the femur and the patella. We will meet you at the next station in order to talk about the bones of the leg. Thanks for your time.